Hi, my name is Leon Rowe, currency trader and trading coach at trading180.com, and welcome to this week's Forex and Gold Supply and Demand Fundamental and Technical Analysis. A warm welcome to you if you are watching this for the first time, and an equally warm welcome to you if you are returning. And don't forget to press the like and subscribe button as it helps support the channel and gets the quality content to the traders that like to trade technicals as well as fundamental analysis. So looking at the week ahead, we have in the US this week will be dominated by earnings reports, speeches by several Fed officials, and housing data. Investors will be monitoring financial markets in the UK following the government U-turn on tax cuts. So in China, the 20th National Congress of the Chinese Communist Party will take place in the third quarter. GDP growth alongside industrial production and retail sales will be released. Also, inflation rate data will is due for the UK, Japan, Canada, and New Zealand. And that actually is important because that will set the tone, inflation data will set the tone as to what central banks are looking to do with their interest rates, right? So we'll get into what's happened in the past and also as well the impacts of, you know, the potential for, you know, certain inflation data may have on some of these currencies. So looking at the, oh, and by the way, just in case you want to know, you know, how to access this, it's on tradingeconomics.com, one of my go-to sites. And if you go to the week ahead, should be somewhere here. By the time you look at it, click on that, and then you can look at the synopsis and then go into, you know, the details if you wish. So starting off on the dollar index. And dollar index is just a measure of dollar strength, and you can see that pretty much the dollar has been appreciating in a dominant currency over the past how long? Probably over a year now. Yeah, it's been a while that I've been, you know, buying dollars, and my bias has been to buy dollars pretty much week in, week out. Hasn't really changed. So, anyways, looking at the my bias, obviously, is to the long side. Obviously, I want to look for, you know, bargains, and just looking at the dollar index gives me an idea as to if I'm buying the dollar in an expensive area or if I'm looking for bargains. And many of you may know this as the moving average. I term it the moving fair value, because an average, if you're speaking in terms of understanding value, then in fact an average, a mean, is actually fair value between an expensive area, right, and a bargain or cheap prices. So in between that, right, would be the average, and that is actually known as fair value. And so personally, I don't look to trade currencies or look to buy or sell currencies that are at least not at some sort of fair value, because anything above fair value, and, you know, fair value over the month, monthly prices, you know, I'm not looking to buy expensive areas. So for the dollar, anything, you know, at fair value and below would be considered, you know, bargain prices. So for me, looking for a pullback before potentially long. Why is that? And the fundamentally, we've got, you know, the Fed's bullard leaves open the possibility of larger December hikes. So the St. Louis chief suggests the Fed could discuss 75 basis point move, says it's too early to alter policy of shrinking balance sheet. And so what happened earlier this week was that the inflation came out, and the term stickier was used, basically, you know, that inflation may persist for a bit, higher inflation may persist for a bit longer, and obviously it's getting a bit difficult for the Fed to try to bring it down, so they have to hike rates now. With hikes, not all hikes are good hikes, not all positive or appreciate a currency, because the economy has to be able to support those rate hikes. If the economy is seen as, you know, contracting or potentially going into a potential recession, then the hikes aren't necessarily the appreciate a currency. But then you can't look at also the dollar in isolation. So you might be thinking to yourself, well, the headlines are suggesting that the dollar is going into, or the US economy is going into a recession. But I think that the dollar, and the market thinks this as well, is that the dollar has been best placed to survive, I guess, a recession, or necessarily survive a recession. If they go into a recession, it could be a shallow recession, whereas the likes of Europe and the UK are likely to go into a deeper recession, right? So there's differences there. And it's the differences, if you understand those differences, will then guide you as to which currencies you should be buying and selling. So there are nuances. You know, we're all going into a recession, but who's the dog with the least fleas, as many of you may have heard me say, you know, many times over the years. Who is the best of the worst? And the dollar is seen as being the best of the worst, at least out of the major currencies. So a Fed hike in this scenario should appreciate the dollar, simply because not only are they hiking quite aggressively, but those hikes should be at least supported by the economy, and you know, low unemployment, higher employment numbers that came out recently also. So the dollar, for me, any pullbacks I think are buying opportunities, and you wouldn't necessarily buy the dollar index, but you would, for example, look for dollar crosses and look to buy those. Again, this isn't financial advice, this is just telling you what I'm doing. So any pullbacks this week are buying opportunities, especially anything below fair value. So that's my bias on the dollar. Dollar yen, very interesting, very, very interesting on the dollar yen, because the Bank of Japan ended up intervening when prices went to the 146s. And so they intervened here. Basically, central bank intervention is just a way for them to kind of support the currency, or to try to devalue or appreciate the currency. They wanted to actually appreciate the currency by stepping in. And so they, but on the, for the dollar index, and because the dollar is so strong, it didn't really have the effect. I mean, it went down, you know, 600 pips, you know, in pretty much in a day. But since then, we've seen this, you know, strong move. So in fact, maybe the 150s, actually, I think anywhere from now is looked at as they could step in at any time to try to stop the devaluation and depreciation of the yen. So, but technically, there's no setup there, right? You're looking to the left, and to me, there's nothing there. I mean, you can look back at, you know, five. Actually, I look back at all. What data does this provide? Doesn't even go back that far, unfortunately, on Oanda. But we are reaching, I think, probably somewhere like all-time highs, or definitely, you know, multi-decade highs. So I do think that this is putting pressure on the Bank of Japan to intervene even more and start to step up the pace of their intervention. So this could be a sell, but there's no technical setup, unfortunately. In the meantime, if you are looking to continue to buy the dollar, I do think now that anywhere, I think, around these lows is going to be really nice. And it's quite a wide area of demand. It's not, you know, the prettiest. People will say, oh well, where do I buy in that demand zone? For me, I think the best area is going to be down right at these lows right here. It's going to be really nice if prices can come down to that 1416. And I you know, I'm a buyer of the dollar yen, which at the moment I'm actually not a buyer of the well, my bias would be to the upside on the dollar yen on a pullback, but I think with all these interventions, it's very tricky at the moment to go against the yen from a risk off and central bank intervention perspective. So I do think that the upside is definitely going to be capped, but if you do want to get long, any pullbacks at least down into the 144s, if you want to go against central bank intervention, of where you want to start to look for buying of the dollars. But I think the 141s might actually be a really nice level technically, and even better would be the 136s. And just zooming out, that just looks like a, you know, a decent pullback. It looks like about, you know, over 1,000 pip pullback, but when you consider, you know, what's happened you know, over the past year or so, it's just a decent pullback, I think. Anyways, so my bias on this one, if I had to go either way, it's a bit of a tricky one. I think with intervention, then I want to go short. Without intervention, if this pulls back just naturally and normally without the Bank of Japan intervening, then I would be long. Dollar Swiss, again, not really a pair I'm looking to trade, but out of the two, you would expect the dollar, US dollar, to be the the stronger of the two. And so, I mean, we are up, actually, I won't delete that. We are up into this supply zone, which hasn't broken yet, but we also are and do have areas of daily supply within these zones. So I think any pullbacks into probably the 99 cent area is decent to look for any kind of long trades. And we've got areas of support in there. I'd say maybe somewhere around there might be used, and also probably down at these potential lows. Let me zoom out a bit more. Not necessarily the greatest, but I think, you know, because the move started really around here, I think any pullbacks to 97.50 is actually a decent for a long trade. That'd be my bias, but again, not really looking to take this trade this pair, simply because the Swiss franc also are hiking on their hiking cycle, and they're also a risk off currency. So I'm looking for better divergences, better pairs of better divergences. The dollar CAD is actually pretty seen as having a slightly better divergence, if you want to call it a divergence, simply because of the CAD being a commodity currency, and in times of risk off, the dollar should be the one that strengthens over commodity currencies, and you'll see that definitely on the Australian dollar and the New Zealand dollar. But where we are now, if you are looking to buy this currency pair, the any pullbacks, I think, into probably the deeper pullback into that demand zone, the 136 ones to 135s, I think is the decent area to look for, or the better pullback, the cheaper pullback. Yes, the Canadian, the Bank of Canada are also hiking rates, but I've been reading some reports recently that in fact they may start to tail off and actually reduce rates, reduce their hiking, like what Australia did, and start to hike a bit less. And so, you know, with one currency looking to obviously hike a bit more aggressively, and the Bank of Canada looking to hike a bit less, then you're seeing this, you know, start to happen in terms of the dollar appreciating against the Canadian dollar. Using, sorry, one second. Yeah, I think that's pretty much it. Any pullbacks, if that's the direction you want to trade in. If you want to get short on the Canadian dollar, I wouldn't use any levels from like 2020 in order to try to look for time any shorts or anything like that. You'd have to really look for prices to prove that this is a bargain for the Canadian dollar by pulling back, and then a pullback up into that zone before looking at getting short. But my bias would be, you know, to the long side. Again, another commodity currency. I've been saying this for a while, that New Zealand dollar, again, not really a pair that I'm trading, but from a commodity currency perspective, the dollar has been, you know, the dominant currency. So any pullbacks into a demand zone, sorry, a supply zone, is really where you want to get short, as long as risk remains off. And so, yeah, I think that's pretty much it. I don't think there's anything really. I mean, there's definitely a historical low from back in 2020, which is definitely being looked at. But ultimately, the question is why do you want to buy the New Zealand dollar against the US dollar? Because if you were just buying it because it's a technical low, then, you know, you're not understanding value, and that's how traders typically end up getting caught on the wrong side and being stopped out unnecessarily. If you know, you know, you have to understand really value and why there's likely, you know, why the New Zealand dollar is an absolute bargain here. And it would be for me if, you know, risk starts to come back on, or if the US economy, you know, disappoints, and the Fed don't necessarily, you know, hike as much as expected, then the dollar has to be revalued. But until, you know, that actually comes about, for me, any pullbacks, you know, is shorting opportunities. Looking at the pound, and the pound, I actually got involved on this trade here. It's pulled back on me a little bit, but I've taken profits on this, so this is a profitable trade. I've just got one position open, small position open, so we're looking, hopefully, you know, if this is the move, then excellent. I'm looking to trade it down, back down to the 105s, so hopefully that is going to going to happen. And if that's the case, then that would be a nice I've got in it, yeah, actually on the close of this daily candle, And so, yeah, looking at maybe about 1,000 pips, just under 1,000 pip move on this trade. So why am I short on this? And it's because for various reasons, but the, and I've been short really for months, since probably around about April on the pound dollar, in terms of my bias. But the dominant hunt, so Kwasi Kwarteng was sacked, and Jeremy Hunt is the new chancellor. And Jeremy Hunt refuses to rule out new U-turn on trust taxes. So trust Hunt meets Sunday at Prime Minister's country residence. UK will account for every penny to reassure markets, Hunt says. And so Chancellor of the Exchequer Jeremy Hunt said nothing is off the table when asked if he will abandon more of Prime Minister Liz Truss's tax cuts plans, confirming that he is now the leading government voice of the UK fiscal policy. So, you know, the market, the bond market, didn't like Kwasi Kwarteng and Liz Truss's tax policies. And so the market, you know, pretty much dictated and said, you know, that you're going to have to do something a bit better, right? Potentially a U-turn. And Goldman Sachs has downgraded UK growth outlook after government tax U-turn. So analysts at US Bank lower their forecast for Bank of England rate hikes, a more significant recession now expected, analysts say. So again, it's not looking great for the for the UK. And as much as, you know, there's a tends to be a dominant focus on the dollar and what the dollar is doing, again, you have to consider who is worse than the US, right? Who is in a worse situation? And for me, it's proven, I've been saying it's week in, week out, that the pound and the UK and Europe are in a worse situation than the US. And if you've been following me for any length of time, and you can see and look at my past Sunday videos, go back all the way to the beginning of the year and see that I've been saying, you know, basically buy dollars. And I mean the pound was actually decent until maybe around about April, and in April I definitely changed my mind on buying the on the pound and started shorting. My bias was to short the pound from here, and so it was just, you know, looking at, you know, pullbacks. That was pretty much, you know, and you can see what's happened. So the dog with the least fleas is actually the, at the moment, currently is the Fed and the US economy, regardless of what the headlines say. And so hopefully, you know, this really does follow through. So deeper recession predicted by Goldman Sachs. So if you are looking at any pullbacks, so if prices do come up, I'm not saying that prices are going to, you know, go, you know, fall to the floor, because that's not how prices, you know, typically work. But if there are any pullbacks, then that should be looked at as buying opportunities, or I'm looking at that as another buying opportunity for the dollar, and to get short on a re-entry if I get stopped out of my final position, and I'll look for another entry for short trades. But if you are looking at long trades, then you're looking at, the earliest is going to be the 107s to look for a buy trade there. And again, maybe some positive sentiment out of the UK, or, you know, a policy change that the market really likes, would maybe be a short term buy for the UK. But then I'd have to reassess that as it comes out. Euro dollar, so the euro dollar, pretty much same situation as the UK euro. The euro is, and ECB interest rate hikes must persist into next year, Kazakhs says. So 125 to 150 basis points of rate increases needed by the end of the year. Balance sheet reduction should also play a role in 2023. So governing council member Martins Kazakh said interest rates should be raised beyond the year end, the time when economists increasingly expect the euro to be in the midst of a recession. So again, you know, that's telling you that, you know, towards the end of the year, you know, and if you're hiking in a recession, you only make the recession worse. So the Europe, again, Europe are in, and the Eurozone are in a really tough spot at the moment, a really bad situation in my opinion. And so for me, it's really just pullbacks into areas like the 99 one cent area, even above for me is going to be decent for any short trades to kind of get in. I wanted to get in here, but it didn't actually hit that supply zone. If it had come into that supply zone, would have got short here. Would have looked definitely for an entry here, but unfortunately it just didn't do that. But if it does come back up here, I'm looking for some shorts. Of course, again, anything can happen. If there's some positive news that comes out of, and lots of positive news starts coming out of Europe, then maybe you want to look for, you know, a buy trade, and the cheapest and the bargain price would be somewhere down at these lows right here. But for now, path of least resistance is to the downside. Moving on to the Aussie dollar, and Aussie dollar again since the since risk off, really. I mean, this year the dollar being the US dollar being the dominant currency, but then last week we did have a surprise hike in terms of the amount of I think it was a 25 basis point hike rather than 50 basis point hike as the market was expecting from the RBA, has just contributed to, you know, the Australian dollar getting weaker. So for me, any pullbacks into a supply zone are really just the buying opportunity that you need for the US dollar. So continued shorts all the way, and, you know, and again, more risk off. In a risk off environment, the US dollar will just, you know, is will appreciate as money flows into, you know, the US dollar in times of uncertainty. Aussie yen, again, risk off situation. Also as well, you had central bank intervention, so the Bank of Japan intervening, causing, you know, this to happen, and so, you know, there wasn't a buying opportunity here, but for me it wasn't really a buying opportunity. Could, you know, you can look at that technically as a buy, but for me the path of this resistance is to the downside. So I think any pullbacks into the 94 area, I think, is a very nice area to look for any kind of short trades, and even better if it comes up to the 96s, because I do think with the dollar going higher and the Bank of Japan more likely to step in, and if they do, that's going to push, you know, especially commodity currencies against the yen down even further. So you could see actually a nice little pullback swing trade all the way down to the 87s if prices can come up to, you know, a decent supply zone, and at least look for some sort of short trade there if you're trading any kind of risk off. And gold, finally gold. So with the dollar being so dominant, you know, gold, you would think that gold is traditionally a hedge against inflation, and inflation being high, so you think gold would be higher. But unfortunately, the market is more focused on getting a yield from the dollar rather than putting their money into gold. And gold pairs drop after US inflation sets stage for big Fed hikes. So if you're holding dollars, then you're getting a yield, right? Whereas gold doesn't pay a yield. I do think though that this is just a massive, and if you want to use the word accumulation, but this is definitely a lot of buying going on from the banks, I think, because they see the recession coming, right? They see next year, you've got the UK, you've got the Eurozone, you've got the US, they're all going, and, you know, the world is going into, you know, a recession. Right, a potential recession. You've got, you know, guardians of the world economy told to buckle up as outlook dims. So as the Federal Reserve start to come to their interest rate hiking cycle, right, to the end of it, right, probably towards, you know, the end of the year into next year, then to fight inflation. But once that is over, then it's my belief that gold, this is going to be an absolute bargain for gold, because the narrative is going to shift in terms of risk sentiment, recession, that's going to be the theme, and then gold would be in the spotlight once again. So it's just a buying opportunity for me. But from a trading opportunity, I mean, this is a really nice zone. Hopefully, you know, you can get something like that, but I think that level may not hold if the Fed is still just really kind of, you know, forcing through rate hikes in terms of bigger than expected hikes. Yeah, I think that's pretty much it. So I do like buying precious metals, but at the moment, trading precious metals is a bit of a headache for anyone who is looking, you know, any any of the gold bugs, silver bugs. Not a great scenario to be in from a trading perspective, but if you're not, if you're just buying the physical, then this is just, you know, absolute bargain prices to look for, just buying, right? So yeah, if you're looking to buy it, that's a really nice demand zone technically. But if the Fed are, you know, still aggressively hiking, then I don't think that level's going to hold. So any pullbacks into, you know, putting a supply zone right there. And then another one, you know, even better would be at the highs. This was, you know, the best area to look for short trades if you were looking to, you know, go short on gold and buy the US dollar. That was fantastic. Picture perfect trade, and then looking for any kind of pullbacks into 1671s or even better 17. But then again, that just depends on Fed's hawkishness really. Anyways guys, that's it for this week. Hope you're all doing well and have a great trading week. Take care and speak to you all soon.